LIGO, this experiment which detected two black holes in orbit around each other, which then collided and merged into one big black hole. And it was like mallets banging on a drum, the whole of space-time, literally space and time ringing. Yeah. And that ringing emanated through the universe. In the particular case of our discovery, what was it? A billion and a half years? Do I have that number right?
The first one? I don't know.
The first one. I feel like that's right.
It's a billion and a half light years away?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like multicellularity was underway on the
Earth. Oh, my goodness.
Right?
Yeah, right.
And I mean, that's happening all over, but this was the one that we were on this collision course with it.
That is
something. And, you know, humans evolve. Einstein comes around and it's at a neighboring star system. It's still on its way here, ringing, space-time's ringing.
If these gravitational waves are emanating from these black holes colliding, are they escaping from inside the black
holes? That's a great question. They are not escaping from inside the black hole. It is ringing space outside the black holes. However, the final black hole has a mass that's less than the sum of the two black holes. The E equals MC squared energy.
Yeah.
The mass that's lost is all pumped into these gravitational waves.
Wow.
So the 30-something solar mass black hole and the 20-something solar mass black hole, when they merge, that black hole is a little lighter than the sum of those two masses.
And are we talking
and
like
all of that energy, E equals MC squared energy, as we know from nuclear bombs, right, is huge. So all of that energy was something like three solar masses of energy.
That's
what I was gonna ask. It's enormous.
Wow.
And that means that that event was the most powerful event human beings have recorded since the Big Bang.
Wow.
I mean, now there have been others, but the power in it was more than the power in all the light from all the stars in the observable universe combined.
So how many of these things have they discovered now?
Well, now, if the instrument were operating all the time, kind of monthly.
Be like one a month, we
detect. Wow. Kind of monthly. And the fact that they're so powerful, people didn't expect the black holes to be that big. So people worried, look, the black holes are going to be a few times the mass of the sun, only 10 times. Like, that's a good kind of canonical 10. And so it's going to be hard to get anything loud enough to ring our instruments. They're going to have to be in real close, and we're going to have to get real lucky, but that's not what happened.
So we got
the black
dozens,
holes are big. Yeah.
Yeah. Do we have hundreds or thousands of times in terms of these collisions?
I would say, well, so in principle, they're happening all the time. They're just too far away.
Mm.
So we're kind of saying out to the distance we can detect. I don't want to say see because none of it comes out as light.
Right.
Wow. All of this comes out in the ring in the black holes. Yeah. It's complete darkness.
Jeez.
So it's one of the rare experiments in astronomy where we're not talking about a telescope collecting light. It's completely different.
So here's a question. If it's emitting all that energy, like three solar masses of energy, it may not be doing it in all directions equally. So could it just like create a jet of gravitational energy and fly off?
You do have to think about the orientation of the orbital plane, you know, so they're orbiting around each other and there's a plane, the orientation of that plane relative to your line of sight or your line of detection in this case. And it does matter, it will change the signal. And so we also, there's some ambiguity in trying to determine things like that.
Well, I guess the question I was getting at, though, is does the new black hole that formed by the emitting all this gravitational wave energy, could that gravitational wave energy propel it to turn
it's a great
into
question.
A black hole that just shoots
through
the galaxy?
Yeah, it can happen. So, so it shoots so much energy in one direction, the black hole starts to jettison.
Yeah.
Black holes can be cruising along. Yeah.
Holy cow. So out of nowhere.
Yeah, I mean, it maybe came in, it all depends on the orbits. Just like the mallets on the drum, if you swirl them around, it makes a certain sound.
Right.
It's very, you know, eccentric, right? Yeah. If it's looping, coming close and going back out again, it will be very different. It'll be like a knocking.
Yeah.
It'll get quiet. It'll bang. It'll get quiet. And then you'll hear it kind of bang, 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 bang.
Wow.
So yes, we can kind of determine its orbital motion as well as the masses of the original black holes. And maybe sometimes there are these funny things that can happen where a lot of energy goes off in one direction and the black hole just starts to kind of wander around the galaxy. But once it happens, it goes quiet. once it forms.
Right, so you get no more data.
So there's actually something really deep about this question of this ringing down. So when the event horizons merge, like this bubble of ink and bobbles down and then goes quiet, that's because something very profound about black holes, and that is that they cannot tolerate any imperfections. And that's actually a deep point. So we've been talking about they cannot tolerate any imperfection. If you took Mount Everest and you tried to put it,
dated a black hole once in my youth. Right. It was,
haven't we all? No. or I was ever, I don't know. But if so, you put Mount Everest on the event horizon, it won't tolerate that bump for long. Okay, it has to shake it off. And one way to see it is kind of philosophically, to go back to my roots, which I disparaged, but. And that is, the event horizon says you can know nothing about the interior of a black hole, right? Okay. You cannot know anything about it. If that bump remained, you would know more about it than you should be allowed to.
Oh, is this that so-called principle? Black holes have no hair?
Black holes have no hair. The idea it can't have stuff emanating out of it, which would tell you, if you could trace the hair, it would tell you about properties on the inside. The event horizon really forbids the transmission of information from the interior of the black hole to the exterior. We've kind of established
that's
that
kind of
in
by
the beginning.
Definition, right?
Right,
so
by definition. So that means that I can't come up to a black hole a billion years after its formation and deduce, that was a blue star.
Right.
Because that would mean somehow information was coming out of the interior. And no information could come out of that interior.
But why is that such a deep thing? Why?
Oh, well, okay, so there's several reasons why it's a deep thing. But in this context, I would say it's a deep thing because it means that there's something featureless about black holes. There are some things I can know about it. Mm. I can know its electric charge.
Right.
I can know its mass.
Yeah.
And I can know its spin.
Yes.
That's it. That's my whole list, right? And so the reason why that's so profound is it means it's not like anything else in the universe which can have flaws and features, right? So even a neutron star can have tiny little features. I could say, oh, that's my neutron star.
Right.
I put a flag on it. I went to the moon, I put a flag on it. The moon has this big crater. It has these, it's a specific moon.
Right.
And it's made up of this stuff.
Yeah.
It means that black holes are so featureless that they're closer to fundamental particles than they are to astrophysical objects.
So if I had two black holes that had the same mass, charge, and spin,
you cannot tell their difference.
And I did the cup game.
There's no meaning to saying which one's which. It's worse than saying, I tracked it in my mind. There's no meaning to saying this black hole is mine, or this was the one I marked, or they are indistinguishable in the same way that an electron is indistinguishable from every other electron in the universe. Yeah. One electron's not a little bit heavier. You can't say, that was my electron that I sloughed off to, this morning. They're so identical that they're technically interchangeable in a very profound way because we think that they're a fundamental particle of nature. So there's something fundamental about the electron. It's indivisible.
Right.
And it cannot be a little faster spin, a little heavier.